Shweta, should I go ahead?
Just checking the channels.
Yeah, okay. Hi, good morning and welcome to this webinar on our new fund offer, the Sundaram Blue Chip Fund, which we have launched today. As you can see from the creative, this is a large cap fund, and that's why we've chosen Sumo Wrestler as our brand ambassador. And the tagline of the fund is size matters, right? So clearly large caps are large in size, but why does this size matter? We'll come to know in the course of the webinar today. So let me begin by putting in context for you, right? In your equity asset allocations, right? You have large caps, mid cap, and small cap. So what should be the general basis for deciding how much to put? Should you put everything in one or spread it out? So now if you look at it, right, I've taken the returns of the large, mid, and small cap indices just to show you a certain points. So first is that if you see currently, this is as of last month end, September 2nd to be precise, right? If you see 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, all the returns are positive. One. The second point that you can note there is that small caps seem to have given better returns than mid caps, and mid caps better than large caps at this point in time. But just if you go back in time to March, the situation was reversed. In March 31st, the 1 year returns were the worst for small cap, less worse for mid cap, and large caps were flattish. Go back a further 3 months in time to December, before the coronavirus crisis came to the world. What happened then? You had large caps delivering double digit returns at 14.4% for the last 1 year then, and mid caps were down 3%, small caps were down even more. So just in the space of these 8 months, you've seen a bewildering variance in the returns of the three indices. What explained this? To understand this variance, right, let's take away the effect of timing. Because I've spoken about three particular points in time. So the rolling returns methodology is that one, which is a bulletproof method, which tells you what you can expect from the past history, often return from various indices, right? So the market volatility, which is what was demonstrated in the previous slide, you can understand that better by a rolling returns analysis. Now, what is a rolling returns methodology? What it means that you start at a particular point in time, you should be long enough for you to have enough data points to make a judgment of the past and a prediction for the future. So this methodology states, so let's take January 2004, just for starters, right? So since then to now, you have roughly 16 years. So if you started on that date and you wanted to evaluate what is my experience of 3-year returns. So on 1st January 2004, you could have made a 3-year investment. On 2nd January, you could have made another 3-year investment. On the 3rd and so on and so forth. Every day for a certain period of time, you could have made a 3-year investment. So through that period, you get a large data point of 3-year returns, which then gives you a sense of how are 3-year returns independent of timing. So this table here shows you the result of such an analysis, right? So what it means is that starting from January 2004, we have got 4,992 3-year observations and 4,261 5-year observations. So you have a large enough set over a long enough period. And now when you look at it, the large, mid and small, I've used the Nifty 100, the mid cap 100 and the small cap 100 to demonstrate my points. The maximum return you got when your timing was good was 48% per annum. Mind you, these are all annualized returns per annum from the large cap category. You got 50% from the mid cap category, but you got 70% from the small cap. So on a 3-year period, and if you go to the 5-year period, you will see the same sort of a thing. That is, the maximum gain that you can get if your timing was perfect is higher in small caps, lesser in mid caps, and lesser in large caps. Right? Mid caps and large caps are roughly around the same. But if you take the opposite end, that you could lose money in the stock market. The stock market is after all a volatile creature, right? Your worst loss is in small cap and a lesser loss in mid cap and the least of the loss in large cap. So as you can see here, this demonstrates certain points about the fact that you can get the maximum return from small cap, but you can minimize your losses best with large cap. That's the point I wanted to show you here with it. And that's why it's important to know when do mid caps perform, when do small caps perform, when do large caps perform, so that you can frame your large cap, mid cap, small cap allocation accordingly. So, right now, this variance that you saw, right? Why is this variance happening? So let's understand that, because you can't make any decision without understanding the fundamentals of this. So stock market delivers returns to investors through two methodologies, right? One is the earnings growth of the companies, which they can give it to you in the form of dividends. The second is the valuation change. So if something is, let's say, they say 15 PEP is a commonly used methodology for valuation. There are other valuation methodologies too. So if you say something, you started at 10 PE and when you're exiting, it's at 15 PE, that 10 to 15 re-rating of the PE, as the word is used, gives you profits. So you make profits from two lines, right? Now, the valuations itself can be split into two. So as I said, most commonly used is PE ratio, because this re-rating can move both ways. Why? Because there is a future earnings, expectation about future earnings, which decides the valuation. Right. And the second is there is a rising falling demand for stocks. Stocks are commodities like potatoes, like oil, like gold or anything. And when more money chases these stocks, the valuations go up. So you make money from the stock market because the PE can rise or fall. So you can lose money from the stock market because of this, and you can make money because of this. So essentially, to summarize, there are three. Right? The volatility arises due to current EPS fluctuating, and second, the valuations fluctuating, either because of the future EPS expectations going up or down, or because the demand for stocks from a liquidity perspective goes up or down. So this is the framework of your decision making, which you should use to make that decision. Now, why is there this volatility? Because there are three certainties in life. Commonly, there should be two, saying death and taxes, but I've added a third, saying business cycles are also certainties in life. Why am I saying this? Let me explain what is a business cycle. So generally, you can classify business cycles into virtuous cycles and vicious cycles. As you can see, virtuous means good, vicious means bad. So what is a virtuous cycle? You have the key part of a cycle is the bottom half of this graph, the two cycles there. The high demand followed by rising capacity utilization in the economy, followed by corporates then making fresh investments. So the supply comes in and low inflation and low interest rates result from that. That's how the cycle gets completed. In a bad cycle, the demand gets depressed. So capacity utilization falls. So nobody's making investments. Then supply constraints come in and inflation goes higher and higher, right? So broadly, economies have to go through these phases because this capacity utilization versus demand. If you see those two points, demand generally rises linearly, 8% per annum, 10%, or it falls linearly, 20% per annum, 20-30%. But capacity utilization cannot be linear. Capacity always comes in steps. Take Hero Honda, for example, if you take. They are a motorcycle manufacturer. Now, if they have to make motorcycles for the future demand, they can't do, let's say demand is growing at 10%. They can't set up an entire factory just for 10% more. They have to look at the five-year period and set up a capacity for 50%, which will gradually get used up over the next 5 years. So the bulk capacity, when it comes in, it causes a lower capacity utilization and hence the cycle. So if you can understand clearly, there is no way we can escape the cyclicality's impact on the economy. Now, this economy cyclicality naturally leads to cyclicality in the stock markets, right? So just to demonstrate that, I've taken the Sensex, the mid-cap and the small-cap indices, and I've taken that from April 2003 to today, a period of 17 years. As you can clearly see from the shape of these graphs, right? The virtuous cycle leads to a rise in the stock market. The vicious cycle leads to a fall in the stock market. The next virtual cycle was a rise in the stock market, next is a fall. And you can see the three colored lines are the large cap index, mid cap and small cap. They behave differently. So that is the crux of the argument, that a knowledge of where we are in the cycle will help you make the decision on asset allocation. So how does this play out, right? Because business cycles impact the earnings of companies in the current. So the cycles are low, naturally earnings are down. It also impacts the expectation of future growth. So if you are in a cycle and you are expecting the future also the cycle to continue to be bad, then the expectation will be down. Now, at the same time, the business cycle also leads to liquidity, right? So governments try to print their way out of a down cycle and they put flush more liquidity. Now, whether that liquidity comes to the stock market, and if in the stock market it comes to large cap, mid cap, small caps, keeps varying depending on this outlook. So all the three factors, and this slide will keep coming back again and again, friends, decide what happens to large caps, mid caps, and small caps in good cycles and in bad cycles. So if you see here, the same cycle which I showed graphically, I've split it in a table. And the left-hand side of the table tells you there's a good cycle happening, and the right-hand side tells you what happens when there's a bad cycle happening. This is starkly clear. I've highlighted in green when there's been positive returns, and in red when there is negative returns. So those data stares at you in the face that when there are virtual cycles, all the three indices show positive returns. But point to note is that in good cycles, small caps do better than mid caps, and mid caps do better than large caps. Can see in both the cycles that trend is maintained. Whereas if you go to a vicious cycle, as you can see, even in vicious cycles, though they come down, large caps tend to protect your capital. So they are in green territory. Sometimes they give you positive returns. Whereas mid caps hurt in bad cycles, small caps hurt even worse. So this is what I've summarized in the writing below the table. Large caps give you protection in bad times, but don't give you as much return as mid and small caps in good times. So in deciding how much to large, mid and small, if you can get your business cycle prediction right, you can make the perfect switch from large to mid to small and minimize your losses and maximize your returns. But as you know, nobody is an astrologer. We can't ever get it perfectly right. So what happens if you blindly choose? That's what, if you remember, I used the rolling returns analysis. I'm going to repeat that for you. The first two I already showed you. The bottom half tells you what is the probability of losing your capital if you're just blindly putting the money without putting your mind to whether we are in a good cycle or bad cycle. The probability of capital loss in large caps is 7%. So in a cycle, I said it protects, but that's only if you stay the full cycle. So the 3 years is not a full cycle. Some cycles have been 4 years, some cycles have been 5 years. So if you stay only for 3 years, there's a 7%. Whereas you stayed for 5 years, the chances of losing your capital are only 2%, right? 98% of the time, your capital is protected. But you can see in mid caps that rises to 15%, and in small caps it goes to 26%. So your chance of losing capital is 4 times as much as the large caps in a 3-year time frame, and 9 times as much as the large cap in a 5-year time frame. So I hope I've given you the perspective on how you should be going about choosing. So let me now tell you again that the reason for the large caps doing better in vicious cycle is because in the current EPS growth, as well as the expectation of future EPS growth and the demand, large caps are less affected. Why? We shall see. But to then put things in perspective, this is the risk return graph of the capital markets. So I've started with the debt products, which are liquid, short duration, range of debt products, which are, so if you see, there's an x-axis and a y-axis. So the x-axis is low return versus high return. The y-axis is low risk versus high risk. So if you now look at it, the fixed income products all come in the low risk, low return aspect. Then with something called an aggressive hybrid, which is the old balanced fund, is where you start entering into equities. And because the hybrid contains 30% of fixed income or debt, as the case may be, it is less risky. Then when you come to the pure equity products, you can see that large caps are actually at the median of the entire capital markets risk return graph. So within the equity categories, pure equity, they are the safest of the products. But as you go up, mid caps, small caps, and then you have the sectoral funds, which are the highest risk, highest reward asset classes in the market. So this tells you correctly what should be the large cap space in a risk reward scenario. So now, coming to you as an investor, how do we go about this, right? First, in any investment, you're ultimately trying to build wealth for the long term. Please remember, the equity markets are not for short-term plays. They are meant to build wealth for the long term. Okay, so this is not meant for traders. I'm talking about investors. So first, you have to have a goal. So the first, very first decision you have to do is to have a goal. For every investment, everything that you choose, there has to be a goal. It could be a 3-year goal, 5-year goal, or a 10-year goal, but it should be a goal. Then you have to have a plan to achieve that goal. So ideally, this is where the help of an advisor is greatly helpful, right? So once you've done a goal and then a financial plan that I want this kind of money at this stages of my life, next you judge your risk appetite. Again, the help of an advisor. And a simple suggestion, don't overcomplicate this. Just classify yourself as an aggressive investor, a moderate investor, or a conservative investor. That should satisfy for most purposes. Third, don't put all your eggs in one basket. That is, don't put everything in large cap or everything in small cap, whatever it may be. So what it's saying is that in consultation with your advisor, please diversify your basket across the Capco-specific mutual funds. And once you've done that at a particular point in time, you have to regularly evaluate your basket in the context of the prevalence stage of the business, right? So as you go through your 10-year investment, you have to reevaluate it constantly so that if you need to change based on the business cycles, you can do the change. So this is a simple step or process. So let's first look at it from the risk. Then we will go on to the economy situation and what you should do in the current market scenario, right? So okay, so suitability of the large caps to investors, right? So clearly they are the safer of the bit. So capital appreciation over the medium to long term with lower volatility, right? And will be achieved by investment in large cap companies. So investors who need lower volatility are the ones suited to the large cap space, right? So what is the reason for this, right? Because if you stay long enough, what the Nifty 50 has done is that it's given you 11% per annum CAGR over a 15 to 20 year period, right? So in these 15 to 20 year periods, right, if you look at it, compared to the alternative asset classes, which are on the safer end of the risk spectrum, barring that equity carries a risk compared to bank deposits and others, you can see that you're still getting a double-digit return because today's taxation is a 10% long-term capital gains tax, right? So that 10% long-term capital gains tax will bring your 11 to 10%, right? Which is a healthy return, well in excess of inflation. Long-term inflation in India has been of the range of 7%. in the country. So you're still getting a 3% alpha over a longer term inflation. Right. The next is the point is that as an investor, so if you are an aggressive investor, two things, right? Always have a five-year horizon on the equity markets. Second, if there is a certain amount of flexibility, which is what I mentioned in the context of our other aspect, right? So now, right, if you now see large caps, mid caps, small caps, the suggestion today is to have 50% in large caps for an aggressive investor also. But 1 year later, you can reduce it to 30%. Why? I shall come to it later in the context of the current economic scenario. But for now, take it that I would suggest today for an aggressive risk reward investor to have a 50% large cap exposure. And if you then come to a moderate risk reward scenario, right, I would say you have 70% in large caps, 20% in mid caps, and 10% in small cap with a suitable alteration in about a year. A conservative investor today should have 80% in large caps and probably 0% in small caps and maybe 20% in mid caps. So this is the way I would classify the situation. So clearly, for the next 1 year at least, the portfolio should have a bias towards large caps with the flexibility to alter it after a year. What are the reasons? As I mentioned, the next point is the business cycle. So what is the business cycle outlook? Let's get an update on India's economy. And as you can see here, the gross value added, which is a form of GDP, which is the three industries put together, services, industry, and agriculture, three sectoral segments of the economy, have been on a downturn for a fairly long period of time, notably from the last quarter of 2017-18 itself, the GVA has been on a downturn. So Indian economy has been on a slowdown for quite some time. And then you had the coronavirus come and hit our economy, and we are down about 24% in the first quarter GDP. Yes, a lot of the countries are down, but clearly we are the worst affected in the world, right? Now, there if you see, the components which are bringing down the GDP are industries down by 38%, services is down by 39%, agriculture is slightly up. So clearly, from a cyclicality perspective, we are in the midst of a vicious cycle, right? Now, this cyclicality of the economy leads to cyclicality in the stock markets, as I have explained. And so today, we are in the midst of a vicious cycle, which started in December 2017. And since then, the Sensex has still given you a positive return, but the mid cap and the small cap have clearly lost money, right? So when you now look at it, it's because this vicious cycle has affected first the earnings growth. So if you see, the stock market earnings have displayed the massive COVID and lockdown impact. So overall market for this quarter, 2,500 companies surveyed, the PAT, the profit after tax, is down 46%. And you break it up within large caps, mid cap, and small cap, you can see that small caps are the worst hit in terms of the current EPS and large caps. So the returns of the stock market are partly explained by the current EPS story. And next is the earning growth expectation. So in the earning growth, the immediate earnings outlook is still weak because the GDP, while it was down 24%, is still expected to be down 9% next quarter, 1.7% down next quarter, and maybe in the last quarter of the year, it could turn positive. So the immediate earnings outlook is also negative from the stock market perspective. And then when you look at rising falling demand for stocks, see, large caps have delivered positive returns. That's because FIIs, since April, have invested 83,000 crores in the Indian stock market. So that's why large caps have given you positive return. So liquidity, like I said, liquidity is also a function of business cycles. So when the business cycles are down, governments and governments across the world have been printing money, and that money tends to filter down into various countries based on the outlook. So FI outlook for India has been turning favorable, and about 80,000 crores has come in since April. But domestic mutual funds, because they are more sensitive to the local economy, actually have sold 17,000 crores almost worth of stocks in the same period. So the liquidity scenario also varies because domestic MFs, right, have felt that given the recent outlook, the future, they don't want to take the risk of buying stocks today when the FIIs are buying. So that is the broad scenario today as far as the thing. But we have to be flexible in the future. Why do I say that? Because economy is not going to continue to be. So you have to look at what are the indicators for the future of the economy. So the first is there are some positives in government spending and agriculture, even in this bad quarter. So you see, government has been steadily stepping up their spending to try and boost the economy. So government spending is in double digits, and agricultural growth also from a negative has now turned to a positive territory. And the outlook for the future, we will look at the fact that there are green shoots coming up visibly. What are those green shoots? First, the lockdown had led to an NPA problem, which was solved by giving a moratorium. As the moratorium came to an end, RBI stepped in to set up a resolution framework under the Kamath Committee. The Kamath Committee's recommendation says that, so apart from the AAA and the A-rated companies, which are high quality, in the BBB, about 71% of the companies are going to be qualified for the resolution. That's good. But as you go work down the credit curve, the number will naturally become less. And you see, industry-wise, construction, real estate, chemicals are going to be the key beneficiaries of this resolution exercise. The other thing is, as I mentioned, agricultural growth was positive because recovery from COVID in rural India, right, this started with the kharif crops sowing well. So if you see the percentage of normal area sown, we've come to 100%, which is way above what it was in the last 5 to 7 years. So the agricultural growth, which is now reflecting, is the rabi crop. So the kharif crop should hopefully give a better agricultural GDP growth, which should ease the pain on the overall GDP, right? And hence, also the migrant labor moving from urban India to rural India has led to a lot of labor supply available for kharif sowing. Plus, the government has also provided employment. So there's a 40% increase in year-on-year employment through the NREGA program. So naturally, in the rural economy's recovery, rural-oriented vehicles like two-wheelers and passenger vehicles are beginning to show less and less of a negative. They're yet to turn positive. But tractor sales, which are clearly rural and agriculture related, are actually moving to positive territory. So these are green shoots. And to summarize, the kharif sowing is progressing well. And in urban India also, we have a range of indicators to indicate that things are slowly turning around, right? Traffic congestion is picking up. Compared to other countries, India's traffic congestion is relatively higher, which means we are recovering faster. TV television advertisement is going up. You have e-way bills, the government purchases through, also showing a rising tick. You have freight in cement, steel, coal, fertilizers, all showing varying levels of V-shaped recovery. Electricity consumption is showing a rising trend. And overall unemployment has almost come to pre-COVID levels. In rural, it has come back. In urban, it is a step behind. So overall, if you were to summarize and put together all the economic activities, estimates are that we are at 90% of pre-COVID levels as an economic activity. So there are green shoots available. And hence, the forward-looking indicators like a PMI, the services PMI, has shown a V-shaped recovery, but not yet at a 50 level, which is indicative of positive growth. Whereas the manufacturing PMI has touched us 50 and hopefully will sustain, right? So, in short, there is an expectation of a V-shaped recovery in the Indian economy, despite the current bad cycle, right? So this V-shaped recovery is driven by the fact that we did a lockdown to contain the virus and an expectation of a vaccine and a cure in about a year's time, right? So this is the shape of the GDP, which you already saw in data terms in quarter on quarter. So summarize, IMF expects that India will end with this calendar year a negative GDP growth of 4.5%. But by next year, we should have a positive GDP growth of 6, right? But there are risk factors to this growth. What is the risk? First risk factor? The risk factor is that initially the cases were in urban India, 80-20, first 4 months. But as they unlocked and then the cases started coming down, the share of rural India has started going up. In fact, rural cases are rising at double the rate of urban cases. And so this is the risk to the recovery of the Indian economy. And even in vehicles, I mentioned that rural-related vehicles are back, but the freight-related vehicles like trucks, buses, and three-wheelers, they are still at very low compared to last year's average. So they have to come up yet, right? And on retail also, if you see year-on-year YOY comparisons, show that while there is a recovery, business is still 52% lower in August compared to last August, right? And the same with consumer durables are slightly better off. And you take the large retailers, small retailers, all are equally affected. So we are still in a negative year-on-year growth as far as the economy is concerned across various indicators. And this is true across all regions, east, west, north, and south, right? So as we now move to the impact on the stock market, right, you can see that the valuations are showing that emphasis. That is, from the peak of December 17, you see the large cap valuations have been flat. But the mid caps are down 7% and the small caps are down 3%. So as you focus on the large caps have been supported by FII flows. Why those FII flows are coming? Because of the V-shaped recovery for the next financial year. So as you can see here, from a EPS of Nifty, which is around 480, 470 levels, next year is expected to go to 660. So FIIs are coming on that basis. FIIs are also coming because India's valuation compared to the world. So overall, the emerging market are at the least valuations. And within the emerging market, India, in comparison to the emerging market, always traded at a premium. That premium came down. So as you can see, the downtrend in the green graph and the downtrend in the blue graph, both are indicating that India's premium with the emerging market and with the world started correcting. So from an FII perspective, it is an attractive market given our historic premium. Right. So this is going to be supported for the future by a positive long-term outlook for India, because there are a lot of FIIs who come with a long-term in mind. So from that point of view, right, pension funds and sovereign wealth funds, the China opportunity represents a strong advantage for India, and which the FIIs are clearly looking at as a future growth story for India. What is this? China's labor has started declining from 2017. Our labor is continuously rising for the next 30 years. In fact, in the 10-year period, China is going to lose 21 million people, whereas we are going to add 116 million people, right? And if you then break down this workforce by skill levels, we have adequate skill level workforce in every type of skill, basic, moderate, advanced, compared to our competition. And China's per capita income is at $10,000, India is at $2,000. So it's a huge labor cost advantage. So there's a labor supply advantage and a labor cost advantage. And the COVID crisis has made a big difference to manufacturers who have based their factories in China, saying we intend to relocate out of China. So this represents an opportunity for all the competing countries in the Asian region. Vietnam is at number one because they have been tied up with China for a long time. India is at 70 billion, but the prospect of India overtaking Vietnam over the medium term is very good, because FDI has been on a rising trend in India, as you can see. So foreigners are investing in India, and the government has been taking a number of initiatives to get more FDI, including the cut in tax rate from 35 to 17 for a new company. We are now at the best tax rates in the world. We have also removed dividend distribution tax and given 100% waiver for wealth funds from any income from India to attract more foreign capital. Right. Plus, we have improved our ease of doing business ranking. It's a big positive for India, 79 rank improvement. And in specific segments also, we are willing to act. Like in electronics, government has announced a $7 billion plan to give a production-linked incentive of a 4 to 6% on incremental sales. As a result of which, we expect 60% of the world's mobile phone manufacturing value, which is Apple 37 and Samsung 22, to gradually shift to India. And almost 11 lakh crores of mobile phones will be produced from India, and about 12 lakh jobs will get created. Just a specific example of the government's willingness to act. So as a result, to summarize, India, both from a financial attractiveness perspective, taxation, people skills and availability, and the business environment, to ease of doing business, is already among the most attractive countries globally. And hence, in the next 4 years, India is expected to go from not being in the top 10 in 2008 to, by 2024, the third largest economy. So clearly, this long-term growth potential in India is one of the reasons that FII money has been favorably coming to India. Now, is there liquidity going to be available? Outlook could be favorable, but money should be there. Ample liquidity is available because of the COVID crisis. Rate cuts, monetary action, and the fiscal action meant that the rates have down now from 202% to 0.2%. The balance sheets of the central big bank countries have all expanded. That means they have printed a lot of notes. And you're seeing that now money has started going out of gold. 1 month return of gold is 4.4 negative into equities, out of fixed income into equities. And there's also about $3.5 trillion of cash lying in US cash holdings, cash mutual funds, without any return. And of that, I think at least about $2 trillion we can expect to move into the equities markets. And the outflows, which happened because of the coronavirus crisis, also have stabilized at about the historic low levels of 1% minus of the total average, and are poised to bounce back. The US markets are already showing the effect of that, with a 20% rise in the Dow Jones and a 40% rise in the NASDAQ. So we can expect India to also get a share of this, because the G4 banks are going to print $13 trillion more of money through asset purchases in the coming period. So a sustainable liquidity is likely to be available for the large cap space in India and domestic MFI. If there are times and periods when FIIs sell large caps, domestic MF, today they are not buying, but because FIIs are buying, but FIIs are selling, domestic MF AUM also, 31% is in large cap and multi-cap of all categories put together is 38, pure multi-cap is about 19, half of this. And all of this investment means that about 68% of total mutual fund investment, 6.5 lakh crores, is in large cap stock. So there is enough liquidity available for large caps for buying if the FIIs sell for short periods of time. This bias has been further likely to increase because of the SEBI guideline on multi-caps, which has recently come. What is that? The total multi-cap AUM of 1.5 lakh crores, SEBI said that you have to have a 25-25-25. So we expect that there will be a reallocation. How much? It depends on the investors and what the AMCs do. So whether they recategorize their funds into large or large and mid-cap, or they merge it with their large cap or large and mid-cap, or they ask the distributors to switch into their large and mid-cap and the investors, and then they will sell large caps and buy mid and small caps. So clearly from an investor action, those people who chose multi-cap for low risk reward, they will switch to large caps. Those who chose them for moderate risk reward will switch to large and mid-cap, which is the moderate risk reward. And then those who chose it for flexibility, either they will try to do their own large, mid, small allocation, or if they are comfortable with the higher risk of the multi-cap, they may do nothing. So as you can see, there is a chance for money to shift into large caps, which means the industry will end up buying more large caps. So that bias of liquidity favoring the large caps is there. And as we move now, large cap companies' characteristics are that they have proven business models, their size matters to them, the stability is across business cycles, as you have seen, the management bandwidth is wide and deep, their strong balance sheets help them acquire capabilities and growth through M&A. So as a result, in the stock market, they are having high liquidity and a well-researched universe, right? And even large cap also, stock picking matters. So if you take the Nifty 100, which has 100 stocks, right, it has 46 consistent stocks who have always been in the index. So as a fund manager, if you are in a position to identify those picks and stick with them, the kind of additional return potential of such a decision and a strategy would be that 100 rupees would grow to 240 in index would have gone to 289 in these 46 stocks, which means you got about 49 rupees more for every 100 rupees invested by the stock picking process. And these are some kind of companies which have compounded in the past for the long-term large cap companies. And at Sundaram, we have a research team which is focused on disciplined investment process to pick stocks. And hence for this fund, right, we are going to use a blue chip three-pronged quality framework. That's why we've named it the Sundaram Blue Chip Fund. What are the three qualities we're looking? These are non-stock market quality. These are quality of management, which is capable and credible managers and strong corporate governance. Quality of the business model, which is competitive advantage, strong process and systems, and a brand and franchise which have lasted through various business cycles. And ultimately, the financial quality is also important in terms of the return on equity, as well as the cash they generate, and the how much of debt and how much of equity they have. So this is the framework. And this framework, if you look at the industry, there are about 35 large cap funds, of which 7 have named themselves blue chip. So those 7 funds you take and analyze today's returns, because I would say that blue chips imply quality. Now, one fund house to another, the way they define the blue chip could be different. But ultimately, they are seeking quality. And what this slide tells you is such as these 7 blue chip named funds have actually beaten both the index and the large cap category average over the last 1 to 7 years from a point to point perspective today. That is as of last month. So this indicates that the market also respects this quality framework. So 3 case studies to point out to you. One is Tata Consumer Products, right? Where to show you the how a blue chip will be identified and invested in. So Tata Consumer is a large brand. Tata's brand name is there. This is a merger of Tata Tea, Tata Salt, Tata Coffee, you know, put together. So such a company, if you see, their sales has shown a growth from 6,700 to 10,000 crores. And next year, we're going to end up at 11,000, which is doubling almost over 2017. We bought the stock then. And if you see the earnings per share, they have doubled from 6 to 11, right? So though the price earnings ratio was high at 90, because the earnings have been better than expectation, that P ratio has come down to 66 for this year. And for next year, it's going to be 47. So such a stock has delivered. something like 42% per annum return since we bought it in Jan 2015, whereas the index has delivered only 7%. So clearly indicative of the kind of blue chip we might buy in this fund in terms of that one example. Another one is Bharti Airtel, which gives you the benefit of being in a strong industry, because as a company now it's become almost like a 2.5-player industry, as you know. But Bharti Airtel is a dedicated telecom player, also carries the advantage of having Singapore Telecom as an investor. And here again, if you see as a company, in all the challenges, it has been able to maintain its operating profit margin, EBITDA margin, fairly steady over this long-term period. And while the PE ratios have been high because of their net profits being low, the fact is in the stock market, this company has delivered 17.9% return to the portfolio, whereas in the same period, the index has delivered only 7%. Clearly, our view of the telecom sector from the future is also positive, and hence, these are the kind of companies that we can look at. So third company that I've chosen to describe as a case study is the life insurance industry, where SBI Life Insurance, which has got a strong brand of the parent, 20,000 branch network, already the largest private player with 23% share. And such a company also, if you see its enterprise value has doubled from last year to expected to next year. The EPS has also doubled from 11.5 to 23. And though the P ratio was at 75, it has steadily come down as the company has consistently beaten the earnings expectations. And such a stock has also given you 10% per annum since we bought it, whereas the index in the same period was 3.6. So three case studies I've shown to you of the way we will analyze blue chips and look at the industry, look at the company, look at its ability to gain market share, to be a big company. So those are the things I want to point out. I'm not saying that this will be part of the portfolio, that we cannot say. So these are the kind of companies that we have chosen in the past and demonstrated how your blue chip can be selected. To summarize, the fund is going to be a diversified fund, with about 45 to 50 stocks, right? And the bedrock of the fund is going to be a diversification in terms of number of stocks, of quality framework, which I already spoke about, and to have a blend of growth and value in this approach, right? So that's that. In summary, is the fund. It's a open-ended fund investing in thing. 1% exit load. Mr. Rahul Bajal will be the fund manager for this, and Mr. Krishna Kumar, the CIO, will also support him in this, right? So with that, I'd like to end my presentation, and if there are any questions, I'm happy to take that. Thank you.
Our first question, sir. Should we invest a lump sum in Sundaram Blue Chip Fund now?
The choice is yours, because given the situation of the market, the fund manager with the extra profit will try to stagger the investment in the market. But I think the best way to look at lump sum as SIP is, if you are looking at a long-term compounding, SIP is the best. But if you are in the receipt of some bulk funds, then from a perspective, the large caps represent the best low volatility aspect. So you can choose a lump sum. So I think at this point in time, it's a more of the investor mentality of yours. So if you're a salaried person receiving a regular income, opening an SIP is a good idea in this fund.
Our next question, sir. How is blue chip different from any other large cap?
Okay. So typically in the large cap, there are three styles at play. So there is a diversified large cap, which says that I'll buy everything within the index or outside and try to deliver return. So these are generally named as large cap funds. So then there is the second type of large cap, which is that which chooses to filter, like blue chip is one filter, which I just explained that there are seven such filters. So that is one. Now the blue chip funds can be diversified, or the third category, which is that you can have concentrated large caps. Right? So people who run concentrated portfolios, not diversified portfolios. So there, they can be either pure large cap funds, or they could be from the focused category, but essentially large cap oriented focused. So once you choose a focused category, you have to restrict to 30 stocks. So essentially the large cap category, I would say, has two filters. One is you can look at it as plain vanilla versus blue chip. That's one way to look at it. Another way is to look at it as diversified versus concentrated. So I think different, the concentrated is naturally higher risk reward than the diversified large cap. So accordingly, your allocation as thing, it should be somewhere lesser than large cap, but higher than mid cap in terms of a focused portfolio. So these are the types of large caps that are there.
Thank you, sir. We have no further questions, sir.
Thank you very, very much. Look at this. Consult your advisor if you have one, and then take a decision on investing in the fund. The fund is open till the 30th of this month for subscription. Thank you. And we do have digital modes of making payments as well as paper-based, check-based approaches. You can also start SIPs digitally through the e-match process, which we have facilitated for this. Thank you, and all the very, very best.